god. Oh my god, that feels amazing. Oh goodness, thank god Larry's contract is being put to work. And I what? We're on? Oh yes. Welcome ladies and gentlemen to another illustrious episode of the Yin and The Yang podcast. Oh my god, have mercy, am I hurting today like you wouldn't believe. And I'll explain why in a little bit, but right now I just wanted to say welcome to the Yin and The Yang podcast. I have nothing prepared today. This is the first time in 60 something episodes I am unprepared, because I am recovering from the day of debauchery that was Monday. And man, I'll tell you all about it in a little bit, and I am just hurting so bad right now. Folks, I'm not my usual chipper self, just because I am injured badly. And but nevertheless, this show is powered by the More of the Same Network family of podcasts in association with Anti-USW Productions. If you don't know who I am by now, well, then let me introduce myself. My name is Anthony Chu, a.k.a. Chuzilla, the ultimate thriller, all muscle, no filler, the lifelong residential martial artist and avid running enthusiast. Oh, yes, and former two-time USW heavyweight champ, by the way. And to join me in the co-navigator's position, allow me to introduce to you my co-host for the last 60-something episodes. That's been my blessing and my curse. Allow me to introduce to you the man. I give him his theme song this week. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce to you my co-navigator in the hot seat for this episode. Ladies and gentlemen, he is the king, the guru, the owner of the More of the Same Network family of podcasts. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce to you Larry. I own you all, and you owe me nothing but your lies, Mormon.
Years ago, professional wrestling was done by the whatever. Remember the wording in the beginning?
I can find that.
That's awesome.
I can find that for you right now.
No, that's good.
Do you remember that?
Coliseum home video, of course. And then they cut to Hulk Hogan winning the title. You know, that was like the last scene. Hogan pinning
the
Iron Sheik.
Which, by the way, this past week... celebrated 35 years ago.
35 years of Hulkamania.
Hulk beat the Sheiky.
Yeah, man.
To win the championship. And even I was like, whoa, that's a long time ago, man. Yeah. When that happened, I was only 6 years, no, 8 years old.
I was four. In 1984. I don't even think I was three in January of 84. So I had no clue what was going on. Pardon me. I just need to set my throat. Folks, this episode you may hear, my throat's a little parched. I just need to take a sip here with it. Just bear me just a few seconds here.
I'm drinking Sambucus right now.
Okay,
so
just do that there.
Yeah, it's nice to see that you have the retro gamers thing. Here we go. It began over 5,000 years. You fucks. You know, fucking Jeremiah, what the hell is wrong with you today? You want me to read the thing in the beginning, and all of a sudden now you skip. What is wrong with this kid? Is he okay? Because he seems like he has some... Are you drunk again? He comes back from California, and now all of a sudden, it's like he has a problem with the booth.
Look, I've said my piece with Jeremiah, so it is what it is.
Oh, so all of a sudden, you're buddy-buddy now. He's kissing ass with the boss. Is that what it is?
I mean, you know, it is raise time around here at the network.
Oh! So... No wonder.
I'm just saying.
Now, allow me to read this properly, Larry. It began over 5,000 years ago when civilization was young. Every major culture Egypt, Greece, Rome, India, and Japan studied, practiced, and perfected into a fine art. They admired its Olympian demands, strengths, agility, skill. They did it to honor their gods. They did it to honor their kings. They did it to train their soldiers. They did it to compete. And they did it for fun. It has come down through the ages to us today. It is
sports entertainment.
It is not sports entertainment, goddammit. You see, this is a bygone era when it was professional wrestling, when there was class, there was respect, there was some type of admiration for the athletes and the people who competed because people took this shit seriously. Back then, there were no dick guys, there were no tampon people, there were no invisible hand grenade people. People didn't break out in the middle of a dance routine, and people certainly as hell didn't use cinder blocks, okay, as a mat for a professional wrestling ring. That stupid idiot, what the hell is his name? Stupid, whatever the hell. The guy that has a problem with Cornette, my idol, right?
Who's got a problem with Cornette?
The fucking Kevin Dunn. When he goes, at Corny, we're not wrestling. Well, really, motherfucker? If there wasn't professional wrestling, well, then again, why are there professional wrestlers in a professional wrestling ring, wearing professional wrestling gear in front of professional wrestling fans, wrestling in front of professional wrestling venues in a professional wrestling promotion?
I do have a problem with Dunn. I think the way Kevin Dunn produces the show, like those violent cuts and the camera moves, like I get a headache every time I watch WWE. Not because of the action, because of the cameras.
What did the cameras do to you this time?
They violently zoom in, zoom out. You know, they are all over the place. It's very hard to watch sometimes.
I can understand that.
And of course, the announcement just dropped today that Dean Ambrose will not be renewing his contract when it expires this April.
Wait a minute. I thought you said you don't read dirt sheets.
Oh, no, that was from WWE.com.
They literally really announced that?
Dean Ambrose, real name Jonathan Good, will not be renewing his contract this April, which makes me wonder and worry if Renee Young is going to go with him.
I doubt it.
I apologize. I'm sorry. I thought this was Talking More Wrestling, which drops every Saturday at 6:05 p.m.
You see,
Eastern
on the
road to WrestleMania.
Again, you see, I was hurt, and all of a sudden now I feel a lot better because all of a sudden now it proves once again your hypocrisy.
You want to try that again?
It proves your hypocrisy. Do you know why? Because basically you use my show as a vehicle for your own little pet project over there known as Talking More Wrestling. Yeah, and just like how you used my show's website and links to basically project to the Yin and Yang fans. Yin and Yang fans, I hope that you did not listen to 1 second's worth of that Rumble preview.
Hey, listen, that was a great preview, and there will be new episodes on the road to WrestleMania.
By the way, how was your week?
My week was good. It was actually not too bad, a little on the quiet side. But, you know, this past weekend, NXT TakeOver Phoenix and, of course, the Royal Rumble. I took my private jet to Phoenix to be in my suite at the Talking Stick.
Oh, God. Arena. Well, oh, Lord.
I mean, I don't know if you know this, Lord, but I do own a box suite in every major arena all across the country. So, you know, and if I'm not using it, they have a program where you can donate the tickets to, like, make a wish or something. But I just let it sit there because I really don't need anyone messing up the seats or anything like that. So when I got there, it was pristine. It was held wonderfully. My personal usher, Glenn, follows me and, you know, he helps out, shows me to my seat.
Okay, all right. Larry, listen. This is why every single week I have to reiterate to the fans how much money you're worth, and you don't want to disclose that because the IRS is probably listening
right,
in. They're probably
right,
tapping on.
Hey. Okay, look, the government shut down. They should not be working.
$85 million.
Oh, what? Is that today's New York Lotto? Yes, it is. All right, folks, go play.
I hope that IRS is listening to this, and I hope the IRS will come after you, and they're going to send a guy named Irwin R. Scheister to come collect, and I hope he does collect.
Death and taxes. That was such an odd feud with him and Undertaker.
Yes. Yes, it was. Larry, I'm sorry. What was that, Larry? How was my week? Well, my week was good.
I wasn't done with my week.
You know, you have more?
I always have more.
M-O-H-R, more. Go ahead. What was your week like?
Also, I had this very, very wonderful brunette come over to the house. And what we did is we hook up from the ceiling down.
Oh, I'm sorry. Was that is that a new sensor button? Listen, Larry, I don't need to know what you and this brunette did hooking up. I don't need to know. This is not what the show's premise is about. Okay? It has nothing to do with the content. The commandos and the militants don't need to know what you did. Do you know what you and Waylon Mercy have in common?
What is that?
You're both jobbers.
Ooh.
Anyway, now, so the point being is that my week was...
How was your week, sir?
With well, I'm glad you asked. I asked for you anyway, so don't worry about it. Now, I'm beat up. I'm hurting pretty bad right now. I did something this past week that could have possibly killed me, but did
cocaine?
Not.
Cocaine?
Because... This is a kid's show.
What?
Okay, you want to talk about drugs? Go talk to the retro gamers.
What?
The retro gamers have mentioned drug references many a times.
When?
Listening to that show.
How dare you?
And then all of a sudden you guys talk like it's a PSA, please. Look.
How dare you?
I went snowboarding. And really? Allow me to say that snowboarding just really, really took... I mean... For those of you who have never done snowboarding, allow me to say this.
I've never actually went snowboarding.
Can I finish? Here's the thing. Snowboarding is one of those things, right, where it's like if you've never done it before, just understand this is not easy. This is basically one of those things where you're going to fall a lot. And trust me, boys and gals, I fell a lot, and I'll be honest with you. There was two times where I took a really nasty fall where I think I hurt my upper back. My neck is bothering me. My lower back's bothering me. I fell on my ass on ice. That hurt like hell.
Ouch.
And I mean, literally, like I fell from like about 4 feet up in the air and fell down. And that was not snow. That was not like a dusty snow type, you know. That was not that type of thing. It was like pretty hard. And I just got to the point where I was really hurt. And just wanted to say to my friends who took me, I appreciate the good time. I wanted to give a huge special thank you to my friend Camelia, who really, really helped me out and was very patient with me and never left me because I was in this bunny hill. And then everybody decided to pressure me to go into like this this mountain that was like what seemed like about a few thousand feet up. Mm-hmm. And she took me down the whole way, like more than halfway. And then I nearly broke my ass. And she really, really wanted to make sure I was okay. And I'm just hurting bad, man. I went to go see the doctor. And the doctor says, you're lucky you don't have any head trauma. Thank God for helmets. You're good. It's a lot of bumps and bruises. You're sore. And I must have burnt at least 500-something calories that day because I went snowboarding from 10 o'clock in the morning till about 4 in the afternoon.
That's a long time.
Work, man. A lot of work. I mean, it is fun when you're coming down fast and you're having a good time, but it does suck falling like so many times. And I'll be honest with you, if it wasn't, there were several reasons or several things that protected me from serious injury. The first one I could say is if I didn't have professional wrestling training, I would not know how to take a bump.
Mm-hmm.
And that really helped big time. Martial arts training helps you to teach you to be somewhat relaxed.
Okay.
Even in a falling situation, which is why I didn't get hurt that badly, and then at the same time just being able to have losing the weight that I did really, really helped. Because if I was like in the shape that I was some years back, oh man, I would have been really seriously hurt, because the amount of weight that would have came crashing down would have been not good at all.
Do you own your own like snowboard and stuff?
No, not at all. Not at all. Okay. This is my first time ever. I've never done it before. So it was my first time ever, and it's a pretty expensive sport. So unless you're really, really into it and you're really down with doing this and having a good time, this is some crazy shit. I mean, going down fast is a lot of fun, but if you don't know how to control how to fall or and all that, you can really hurt yourself badly. And I went down pretty fucking quick.
I believe it.
That was wild, man. So,
okay,
Larry, other than that, in which, by the way, speaking of 3 years, last week's Saturday, the 26th, marked 3 years to the day where I started changing my life. And looking back at some photos of what I did, I'm going to post a picture up for everybody on the Yin and the Yang page, and you'll see that, you know, hard work does pay off, man.
If anyone personifies hard work, I won't lie, it's you.
It ain't me.
It's you. You work hard.
I feel like there's a lot of other people out there who work harder than I do.
No, I'm telling you, you definitely do the right stuff.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that. Now, 2019 can just get somebody else I'm talking to on board of this.
I think your life
would be totally different, my dude. And I think that you'd be amazing. You'd feel amazing. You'd probably do better than I will. Can I be honest with you? I really feel if you're talking about application, if you really put 100% into this, I really think that you would progress better than me. And there's a lot of reasons why.
Maybe. No, I don't know. I don't know.
You gotta live to be around to be like 90 something years old to count your riches, man. Don't you want to be around for a long time to make sure that you count your money, to make sure that you enjoy your box suites,
enjoy
the food that there is on earth. Watch professional wrestling.
If I get to like 65, I'm good to go.
Oh, no, stop. Okay, well, then let me ask you this. Let's say if you get more than 85 mil.
What's going on?
I'm just saying, let's say it's more than that. And let's say somewhere in the future you get an inheritance. You got more money.
Hopefully not anytime soon.
Well, I'm just saying for a very long time, but at some point I'm sure you'll get a nice inheritance. Don't you want to sit around and count your riches or do what Scrooge McDuck does?
Oh, dive?
Dive in and just swim on his riches.
I don't think is physically possible to do, but I don't know. We'll see.
Listen, Scrooge McDuck is not no young spring chicken.
No,
either,
he's not.
All right,
he's not.
So if he can go swimming in his gold, then he's at least in duck years, like 60 something years old. So I'm sure you can go swimming. You see, the difference between you and him is that he's the richest duck in the world. And you're just the richest fuck in the world.
Oh. Someone patch me through to Jeremiah. I want his feed to be cut. I want his mic to be cut now.
Now, wait a second. You're not going to cut my...
Is it cut? Good. I will not sit here, because this worked last week, and it was cut last week as well. I will not sit here and be made a tool... By you, sir. All right, and all these fans out here, who are hearing me, who know what the yin and the yang. What was that? What did I hear something? He better be cut. His feed better be cut. Here's what's gonna happen. I'm taking the Yin and the Yang podcast, and I am changing it. I am going to take it on a whole new direction. Can he hear me? No, he can't hear me. All right, good. You see, I took his money, and he doesn't know that I can do whatever I want with the show now. He paid up in full. So, that will be our little secret. that I'm actually going to turn this show into the My Little Pony hit variety hour. And I can do whatever I want with the podcast. And I already have his money. So that bald, panda-looking, svelte, because he is good-looking, I got to admit that, you know, he will rue the day that he messed with the greatest podcaster on the planet today, the man, the myth, the legend, Larry. To be the man, you got to out-talk the man. And by God, no one podcasts better than me, Mormon. Put him back on. Bring him back on. Let's go. Post-haste. Way to go. Did he leave? I'm not doing a show by myself.
My little pony, my little pony.
My Little Pony, greater than Care Bear. I'm telling you right now.
Well, I agree with you, Larry. I'm sure that if you did take over this show and basically turn my show into like the My Little Pony theme show theme hour. I'm sure that it would be a kids-oriented program, and I'm glad that you took all my money, Larry, because I have a little surprise for you. While you muted me, just wanted to let you know that I got off the phone with a certain somebody, and I left them a voicemail, and they said they were going to call me back.
Oh, geez.
So somebody is bound to supposedly call me back in a little bit. And I just wanted to let you know that in the process of while that's happening, okay, you know, it's all right, Larry. I look at it like this. I know for a fact that, you know, we've always had bickering. And, I'm sorry. I think that's my phone. Hang on a second.
What?
Hello? Why? I'm sorry. Hello? Who is this? Hey, what? 你咪讲中文啊? Hi. 你系咪控制阿Larry啲钱喺中国噶? 哦，系咩? 华为啊?
I heard my name.
华为, 其实佢咧就话佢系有几百万系超过嚟你个银行个户口。 失咗定你係咪失咗佢定佢係咪我聽佢有好多報税喎。即係佢報咗税佢就有好多股票。哦係咩?哦,wow,咁啊。OK,我明白,我會通知佢,我就會講俾佢聽,OK?唔該曬,OK,拜拜,拜拜。So Larry, I got some bad news for you, buddy.
What? Did you just take a private phone call?
Yes, I did. Actually, it was with one of your investors in Asia.
Wait, what?
You just lost about
not.
Yeah, you just lost about $2.5 million worth of investments.
What?
In Huawei.
No, because, wait a minute.
Yeah, yep, the U.S. government is actually tracking down Huawei right now. So, yeah, they pulled out of your accounts and they don't want anything to be associated with
what?
You. So, you lost about $2.5 million.
Wait, what? Where's my actuaries?
Anyway, fans. As I was saying, the first topic of this entire show is that now that we've done being wackadoo funny, is the idea that some justice is finally seen in the MMA world, where Conor McGregor had his fight with Khabib in UFC 229, and Conor will be eligible for his return to the octagon on April the 6th after receiving a six-month suspension for his role in the UFC 229 post-fight melee. And the National Athletic Commission voted in favor that McGregor will be fined $50,000 and a six-month suspension.
He was fine. I didn't realize that.
Yeah. Now, on top of that, okay, Khabib, all right, was also fined as well, because Khabib was fined apparently. Let's see here. Khabib was fined. Receives a 9-month suspension and a $500,000 fine for his role in the UFC brawl.
Oofa.
So you got to say to yourself, $50,000 versus $500,000. That's like your entire fight purse and more. You know?
Yeah, that's a lot of money, bro.
Well, when you physically assault somebody, it's like assaulting a spectator. You know, and when you act like a thug and you act like a douche, that's what you get. What do you expect?
No, fair enough. But like I said, I didn't realize that McGregor was suspended, and he's due back in the octagon the night before WrestleMania. Interesting.
But I mean, $50,000? I mean, that's... I just find that kind of like really odd. You know, that's a lot of money, man.
Not to them, though.
Well, I mean, to Conor, $50,000 is nothing. If Conor really, really wants it, I, you know, just pay Khabib's fine so that you can get back into the ring with the fucking guy.
Yeah, right.
You know, I mean, and just say, hey, listen, let's do it a second time.
Was their fight even that good?
No, not really, because it was kind of one-sided. I think that McGregor got his ass whipped.
Yeah.
You know?
So.
What are you shredding back there?
Don't worry about it.
Are you shredding evidence of Huawei? No,
look. We don't need any of that nonsense around here. We don't need that negativity. All right. Do you have the is that the file?
Okay. Yeah. So anyway, other than that,
excuse me. Oh, sorry.
Oh, now going back to what we were talking about, as you can see, folks, you now know why we don't have investors on the show, because we can't get anything fucking organized. Because one guy is shredding evidence back there of his investments.
You hear nothing.
Another guy, all right, is here hurting right now. We have no organized script. There's no producers of the show except for anti-USW. And those people are kind of looking at us going, what the fuck this week? All right. Now, allow us to talk about something of substance. Let me ask you a question. And I want to go back to this entire Dean Ambrose thing, because as we were dilly-dallying here, let me ask you a question. Do you think that what he's doing is actually a good move?
I don't know what his plans are. Is he going to AEW? Who knows?
I guarantee it, he's going to AEW.
I don't know.
If he doesn't go to AEW, what's he going to do? Go to New Japan? I mean, he's going to leave Renee Young in the States while he's over there? Come on, man. It's not going to happen. I mean, he's not happy with the creative direction. But, I mean, look. This is what I don't understand, right? And I never understood this about pro wrestling. It's like you work so hard to wrestle in either bars, high school gyms, bingo halls, like, you know, Knights of Columbus battalions, whatever the case is. And then you go into bigger and bigger shows. And then you have NXT. And then you work up to the main roster like Dean Ambrose did, right? So all of a sudden now, you're in the hottest promotion, the biggest company on earth for pro wrestling / sports entertainment. And then now it's like you're not happy because of the way that your storyline is, but yet you're paid a lot of money to do what you do. You're sitting on top. Even though you're not like the guy, you're not like a Seth Rollins. You're not like, you know, like a John Cena or anything like that.
Or Becky Lynch,
right? You know that the fans love you. The fans respect you. You're a huge name. You're nationally recognized, probably worldwide. Why would you feel like you're unhappy? I just don't understand it.
We don't know if he's unhappy or not. He may just – look, he's been there for 6 years.
According to what I read on one of the these quote-unquote dirt sheets, what, is that
now?
He's very about a couple of days ago was that he was very unhappy with the direction of where his character's building is going to and his development. And they're saying, like, you know, he used to be a guy who held titles, and he was like on top of his game.
He's a former WWE champion,
right? So what I'm saying is, It's like, dude, you're not Curt Hawkins, you know? Yeah. I mean, if and even Curt Hawkins is like really happy to be there and happy that, you know, he's doing his thing. I just don't understand, like, why would you, if you're at the top and the pinnacle, right, of where you want to be, where you worked so hard to be, how could you complain? Because then what are you going to do? Go back into high school wrestling gyms? I mean, that's demeaning.
Well, hold on. It worked for Cody Rhodes. It worked for the Young Bucks.
I understand that. But, you know, remember, it definitely Cody works. Wait a minute. No, but Cody's a different animal. You know what I'm saying? Because he went from WWE to, yeah, he did some indie spots. But then what he did was he signed with ROH. ROH is not a small fed.
No.
And then he signed with, wasn't he an Impact for a while?
He was an Impact first, and then he went to ROH. Impact,
then he went to ROH, right, which are still two big companies, regardless of the barnyard antics of Impact now. I mean, then at the same time, then he went to New Japan. That you can't use Cody as an example. Then he created All In. So, I mean, it's like, you know, talking about being a star of that caliber going into wrestling in a no-name fed, you know, and making barely nothing. You know, why would you want to do
that?
He's
not going to make barely nothing. He'll definitely make money. He has the name, credentials. But again, we don't know. We don't know what he's going to do. He may go to AEW. Let's face facts. All Elite Wrestling, again, is WWE's biggest competition right now, and their first show is at the end of May. So it's, which I find very odd, but also very intriguing. As much as it's basically the Bullet Club, Neville is there. He goes by Pac now. Jericho is the biggest.
Pac?
Yeah, PAC. Yeah.
Oh, for God's sake, really? They couldn't come up with anything more creative than him?
I think that was his indie name.
Okay.
And, of course, Chris Jericho, which that alone is a huge, huge get for All Elite Wrestling. If you know what? If Dean Ambrose does go to All Elite Wrestling and he makes it a successful transition, then we may see not exactly the same thing, but we may start seeing a version of the Monday Night Wars where you see guys jump ship. So, but only time will tell. We don't know. We'll have to see what happens. Now, right now, you know,
whoa, what was that?
What are you doing over there? Now, if
nothing,
what happened?
I'm listening to you.
If what happened on Monday Night Raw is any indication of what Dean Ambrose is going to be doing at WrestleMania, he kind of got into a little spat with Triple H. Now, Triple H and Dean Ambrose at WrestleMania, I will take that in a heartbeat. Nothing's official, and I don't know anything, but it looks like they can lead up to that. Now, I hope that Dean Ambrose's contract does not expire before WrestleMania, because they didn't give a date in April. They just said in April.
It said after.
Okay, good.
A lot of people are speculating and saying in the dirt sheets after.
But also WWE left it open, saying they hope they see Dean Ambrose back in the WWE. So sometimes these guys just also need to take a break. You know, sometimes they just need to just chill out, relax. I mean, as much as Dean Ambrose had time off, he was healing up from a torn bicep, I think it was, had a very bad staph infection. So it's not like he had, you know, vacation time.
Okay.
So we will see. And if you want to hear more about it, tune in this Saturday, 6:05 p.m.
Oh, no.
Wherever you listen to podcasts, for Talking More Wrestling.
What are you going to be talking about?
Pretty much what happened on Raw and the matches leading up to WrestleMania, the two matches that are now official. And, you know, we'll discuss all that and more.
M-O-H-R.
As always.
You know, the one thing about my contract is it states that I cannot stop you from promoting shit. Just unbelievable.
Is your contract up in April?
I signed for another 50 episodes. Damn. How do you not know that?
I don't read these things.
We're already 50 episodes in. We're already 15 episodes in, actually, going on to our 16th or something.
I hire people to read this stuff.
So, in other words, you're one of those so-called, quote-unquote, leaders slash bosses slash supervisors slash that all this, like, so you're the king of delegation. Delegate shit for other people to do. You just basically sit back and collect money.
I like to go by emperor, and B, yes, that a great leader delegates.
And that's a perfect segue, Larry, because speaking of delegation and speaking of emperors, I am actually, might as well just talk about an emperor that got beat up this past weekend by the last emperor known as Fedor. Actually fought in Bellator. He fought, was it Ryan Bader, as the main event. And allow me to say that I've never seen Fedor get knocked out the way that he did.
Did he get laid out?
That fight was basically it was 32 seconds.
Wow.
And all Ryan Bader did was he came at him with a couple of punches. They were going a couple punches back and forth. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Ryan Bader gives him a left hook that literally you saw Fedor's face go the other way. And he just got knocked out cold. And it was like, and then he punched him one more time and the referee stopped it. It was over. So now Ryan Bader joins Conor McGregor. He joins several people in MMA. Conor McGregor, Daniel Cormier, George St. Pierre, I believe. And I think like two other people. Amanda Nunes, holding two belts in two different divisions, because he was already the Bellator lightweight champion, and then he won the Bellator heavyweight champion in that Grand Prix final.
Oh, okay. So now, is that title like defended, or it's always just won in this Grand Prix style?
So the Grand Prix tournament style was a little over a year, and whoever won it would have the vacated World Heavyweight Championship. So now he states he wants to defend both, unlike Cormier. So
okay, well,
I think it's going to be hard because then he's going to have to find a catch weight because you can't go under a certain, or you can't go over a certain weight in lightweight, and then you can't go under a certain weight for heavyweight. So it's going to be kind of odd for him, you know. He's going to probably eventually have to, because I don't see the weight going up and down to be a very beneficial thing to your health.
But there's been a lot. I mean, lately, I feel like it's on an incline with the amount of dual class champions.
Yeah, I've noticed that too. It's weird. Henry Cejudo is another one who has two belts now, I think. Or something like that. It's just really odd. Or maybe not. But, you know, the point being is that within this card, this past weekend, speaking of a perfect segue, one of our favorites made his MMA debut. A man known as Jake Hager, also known as Jack Swagger.
We the people.
The people. And by the way, I am very, very, I'm very high on this kid because, first of all, he came in built, man, Jake Hager. Now,
he's in shape,
allow
brother.
Allow me to say this. Thank you very much. Now, what's interesting about that is that he not only came in shape, okay, but allow me to say this about him. First and foremost, the buildup to this. Okay, was, you know, they're laughing. You know, he's going to be another CM. There's people who said, he's going to be another CM Punk. He's going to be another one of these guys who's just going to be like, it's another, you know, fake pro wrestling guy coming into our world, and he's never taken a real punch. He's never taken a real kick. This was their pre-show, okay? And Frank Mir and James and Frank Mir and I think some guy named something Thompson, like Jeff Thompson, whatever the hell his name was, was broadcasting, and they were saying, you know, he's never taken an actual punch. He's not a professional wrestler. He's a WWE guy and blah, blah, blah. And what's interesting is that they were basically ripping him apart because, look, most MMA people have no respect for professional wrestling, like I've said many a times on this show. And they were like, we're going to see how he's going to do. First of all, the guy that he fought was a big boy, but he kind of looked like he was past his prime when he was a journeyman. So it's kind of like you knew that the guy was – but the guy was legit, you know?
Okay.
So he fought a guy named J.W. Kaiser. And this guy claims to have these amateur bouts, and he's claimed to have these street fights or whatever. But his pro fight record is like 0-1 or something.
All right. Makes sense for someone like that to go up against Swagger.
Right. So all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Kaiser comes in, makes his intro, and then all of a sudden, you hear this. The lights go out. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand up and follow me and put your hands over your hearts and repeat, "We the people." I kid you not. That's how it starts. And R-Truth, Ron Killings, comes out and raps for him coming out. So R-Truth actually led the way, right? Now, he comes out and he's a big dude, man. Like, he got cut up. Really built.
Mm-hmm.
He walks into the ring and he's fighting this guy, and he goes, he took a hard shot to the face.
Hold on. So Swagger, like, his discipline is wrestling.
Yes, because okay. he's, I think, some type of a collegiate wrestler.
So, I mean, nowadays, let me ask you this before we get into the fight. Nowadays, you know, do wrestlers still have a good shot at winning a bout against, you know, Muay Thai or karate or taekwondo?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Because once they get you to the ground, a lot of the strikers are not knowing what to do on the ground to defend themselves.
Okay.
So, I mean, you know, the classic striker versus grappler, I hate to say this, I'm part of the striking crew. But the grapplers, I mean, you know, what they got to do is just get you down on the ground and stretch you out.
Okay.
So wrestling is still an excellent discipline to get into, you know, and to have as a background as an MMA fighter. And Swagger basically just – he took a hard shot from this guy, and he recovered. And he literally took this guy down and started pounding on him. And there was this one point where he took his elbow and gave a hard elbow shot right in the middle of this guy's forehead.
Ooh.
And rocked him hard. And then just pounded him and then put him in a triangle choke. I'm sorry, like this, I guess, I don't know what you call this choke, but it was like a sidearm choke.
Okay.
And just tapped him out.
All right, good for him.
Now, he wins. He's 1-0 now, and he's eager to get back into the ring. Here's the thing. His fight was broadcasted right after NXT Phoenix. Right, NXT TakeOver Phoenix.
Okay.
So what had happened was, I don't know how true this is, I don't know if this was rumored or if this was fact or what, but apparently some people reported saying that they actually tuned into his fight right after the NXT show was over. Did they put it up in the arena for people to see?
Oh, I doubt it.
Okay. Because I know the entire WWE locker room was actually – they posted it on social media that right after the NXT show, Swagger's fight came on. And they were all watching and they were proud. Like the locker room literally erupted when he won. So they were like so happy. Guys like Bray Wyatt.
I saw
one
that.
Of the Usos.
Yeah.
Yeah, they put up – they had that big shirt that has the hand over your heart, you know.
Yeah.
And so you know what I love about Swagger? And call him Jake Hager if you want. I call him Jack Swagger. But what I love about him – well, we call him Jack Swagger because that's what we know him as, right? But let me put it to you this way. Oh, yeah. And in the post-fight, he said something like sometimes it is something that Vince – and one of the people that interviewed him said there was something that Vince McMahon said to you before you came in to fight. And he said, don't lose. And then he says, well, baby, sometimes for you to convince Vince, you got to con Vince. Whatever that meant. And then he just looks at the camera and just goes, we the people. So you know what I love about what he's doing? He's not forgetting his WWE roots.
No, not at all.
It shows you he's proud to be a professional wrestler, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, and he you know, he's proud to be a pro wrestler. He comes in there and he's for real. Like he didn't CM Punk his way through a fight, which is pretty awesome. I'm very happy for that, man.
Good. I'm glad
to
hear.
So I really hope Swagger gets continued success.
Good. Awesome.
Now, Larry, allow me to kind of calm things down a little bit.
Ah, we're at that point.
We are at that point.
Okay.
All right, my friend. You ready?
I'm ready.
All right, here we go.
All right, here then.
Hello, fans, and welcome to another installment of Reclaiming You. And as always, I want to start off, and I'm going to make sure I do this from the very beginning to the very end. Is that for every time we start the segment now, we're going to get into the proper mindset so that you can understand and concentrate. So please stop what you're doing. All right. Please just follow me. We're going to do this a couple of times. And what I want you to do is I want you to inhale and exhale with me. Okay. And the way I want you to do it is, and I think I've shown you this before. So when you inhale, you're going to breathe not through your chest, because that's hollow breathing. What you're going to do is breathe through your stomach and fill your belly full of air. Okay? And then what you're going to do is when you exhale, you're going to exhale slow. And we're going to exhale. Now, what I want you to do mindset-wise is I want you to, when you inhale, I want you to take in that fresh air, that aura that's around you. And I want you to do is when you exhale, in your mind, breathe out everything that was bad, that was wrong, whether it be for the day, whether it be for the week, whether it be for the last time that you heard the show. You ready? So let's do this and let's start this off in this manner. Ready? So let's breathe in. Okay, and exhale. All right, one more time. Let's breathe in. And let's exhale. Okay. Now, you could also do this with your eyes closed if you want. But I want to get you into that proper mindset. You should feel a lot better. And what I want to talk to you about this week is I want to talk to you about, you know, people who give up and people who don't. You know, I went... And I'm still hurting right now. And when I went into this whole snowboarding thing, I didn't know what to expect. And it taught me a lot. You know, snowboarding, this is going to sound odd, but it taught me a lot. It taught me a lot about balance. It taught me a lot about discipline. It taught me a lot about the learning process. I think sometimes what people are very afraid of is they get complacent or they're in their comfort zone. And they want things to change. But if you're in your comfort zone, you don't know how to change because you're always within a world that you know. Sometimes you have to go to uncharted territory, unfamiliar territory. For me, snowboarding is something I've never done in the 42 years that I have life, you know, in this earth. And I've never done it. And I had friends, and I went with friends who have been snowboarding for years. So here I am. In this beginner's bunny, what they call the bunny slope, practicing. And basically, everything from just getting up there to the top and going through instruction and be, you know, and the first time you fall, you know, you kind of look at yourself like, what did I get myself into? So, like in life, a lot of us sometimes go through uncharted territory. We go to unfamiliar territory. And we go out of our comfort zone. And what we do is we're scared. And yet, a lot of us either are forced to or we try to change and break that monotony. All of a sudden, I fall. Now, when a lot of people, when they fall, in other words, they look at it as failure. And if you fail, okay, here's the question. Are you going to get up, brush yourself off, dust yourself off, and then go up there and try again? Or are you going to stop and just basically say, I've had enough? And it's interesting because when you see a lot of young people there, they fall, and then they just say, I've had enough of this. I give up. You know? And is that the right mindset? Is that the proper mindset to go through? No. But for me, I went there from 10 o'clock, and I was done at 4 in the afternoon. And for that 5 or 6 hours, I can't begin to tell you how many times I fell. But here's the point. The point is, how many times will you get back up? And how many times will you try again? Because there are so many people out there who just say, I've had enough. I can't take it anymore. I'm tired of falling. And I'm not having a good time, so I'm leaving. Well, I don't want to get to this, or I can't get to this goal. It seems impossible, right? Or, oh, this is just too hard. And what happens? They leave, and they don't want to do it anymore. Well, it took me at least 15, 20 times to finally be able to slide down and be able to slowly stop and control myself. And when that happened, it felt like $1 million, and I felt so happy. I was just like, wow. Like, I couldn't believe it. And I was just so, you know, and here's the other thing it teaches me is that you have to maintain a certain discipline or balance. If you don't maintain it, snowboarding, you're going to fall, right? So it teaches you how to balance yourself. And in life, we must be balanced. Without that, if you sway one way, if you sway another way, you're not going to have balance. If you just go flat, well, just like in life, you're going to go straight down, right? If you don't maintain some sort of balance or discipline. Now, here's the reality. Reality of it is, my friends decided, hey, let's take Anthony up to a mountain where it's about 1,000, 1,200 feet in height, and let's go down really fast. Okay, well, when I went up there, my friend, Camelia, basically was patient with me. No matter how many times I fell, and I fell hard, and I hurt myself, she checked up on me. But she never gave up on me. She was always, you know, there. And she always made sure that I was okay. And she taught me, and she was very patient with me. And she taught me a great lesson that I want to give to you. Is that patience, being able to be disciplined, not being upset. And if you really care about something or somebody, you're going to invest that time. You're going to invest that energy, and you're not going to give up on that person. And most of all, you don't give up on yourself. So think about that. A non-martial art discipline can teach a martial artist a certain way or a certain discipline. And it can teach us a lot about life. And that is that, do you have that discipline? Do you have that willpower not to give up? You know, at that same notion, you know, am I banged up? Am I beat up? Do I feel broken down? Absolutely. But what it's doing is that it made me that much stronger. Because if I realized that I not only did survive it, but I also felt like there were certain points where I had, as long as I enjoyed myself, I had a great time. I was amongst the people that I'm with. That was what's most important to me. And it also teaches you one other thing. Appreciate the simple little things of life, no matter how little. You know, no matter if it's just rewarding yourself with something, being around good company, having your health, anything. All the simple little basics of life teach you so much to see that bigger picture. So, a little bit of an unusual lesson this week, but I want you to understand that what you have in your possession is beautiful. Whatever it may be, life, health, family, friends, being able to enjoy those moments, those simple little things, those details, that many people take for granted. Don't take anything for granted in this life, you know, except you improve on it. And I think, my friends, I want you to take this segment, listen to it, and really ponder upon your own life. And, you know, you never know what you can come up with. And I hope you come up to great conclusions, my friends. And if you have any questions about this segment, please write to us and email us. And other than that, I want you to think about this. Let's head for another segment next week. So just remember, my friends, don't ink it. Excuse me, don't think it, ink it. All
right. Boy, that snowboarding really was a game changer for you, huh?
Yeah, it taught me a lot, you know. Now, am I retired from it? I don't know, man, but I don't feel like going to do that anytime soon again. But it taught me a valuable lesson. Just let me recover, and then I'll think about it, you know?
All right, fair enough.
So, my friend, this is, I'm sure, your favorite part of the show, where you get to reach into my sack.
All right.
And then you basically pull deep inside that long, hard sack.
Oh, what? What? Hard?
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. That isn't it supposed to be?
All right. So let's get into this. Folks, I'm sorry.
What nice substance do you have?
I apologize for this human being. And I haven't even had dinner yet. And I'm like, yeah.
Well, there you go. It'll help you lose some pounds.
You calling me fat?
No. But I want you to be in shape.
Oh, okay. I am in shape. I'm round. All right. So, Philip Albans from Florence, Italy. He writes...
Albans?
Okay. Sorry, my English is not too good, but I am hearing the show for the first time in Italy. Have you ever been... And would you like to come to my country for a martial arts demonstration and seminar?
I'm guessing this is for you or me?
I refuse to travel outside of the borders.
God's sake, will you stop?
Unless my government asks me to. I'm happy where I am.
Oh, your government's going to ask you for a lot of things this year, my friend. You don't worry about that, especially the Internal Revenue people.
All right, look, stop saying that. Would you? I mean, God.
Sorry, Larry. Sorry. But under investment. Under investment. And by the way, that Huawei thing was a bad investment. $2.5 million.
Oh, hey, anyway, come on now.
So anyway, Philip, as far as me coming to Italy, I would love to come to your country. I've heard a lot of awesome things about Italy. I also, you got to understand, Philip, I grew up with Italian Americans. So, you know, being able to be immersed into that culture is a blessing, but to be able to go into their motherland and see Italy, which is one of the oldest civilizations on earth, I would certainly love to be in Italy, especially, is he from Florence, he said?
Yeah, Florence. I think it's pronounced Florenza.
Okay. I'm sorry that my co-host just butchered your city. But Florence, Milan, I've heard those are some beautiful places. I would love to drink some wine when I'm there. I know it may not be a good thing for a martial artist to have alcohol, but I still want just a nice glass of wine just to see what is the best there. The food, I'm sure, is outstanding. And I've met a lot of very good martial art practitioners from Italy, so I would certainly love to exchange knowledge with them. And absolutely, I would love to come to your country. So for sure. Hey, if you want to set up something, let us know, please.
All right. Next question. Evelise Sanchez from Torrance, California writes.
Evelise? Is it Evelise you're saying?
I don't know. Evalese.
So it's Evelise, no?
Evelise. Evolution.
Tomato.
Great tomato. Show. Great show. I have a question for Anthony. What is your opinion about people doing got yoga? What the hell is got yoga? I wanted to try it. Should I?
Is she? Wait a minute.
I think this idiot mistyped.
Hey,
guy.
Hey! Don't make fun of our fans. What the hell's wrong with you?
Listen.
What if, is she? Okay, so if she did a typo, you know. Listen. You know,
hot yoga?
Apparently your investing is a typo.
Would you stop? All right.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry. What are you shredding again?
Don't worry about it. So I'm assuming this person has fat thumbs and couldn't type hot yoga.
I can only imagine. Hot. I think she's typing goat yoga.
Goat yoga? What the hell? Goat yoga? Oh, goat yoga. I think my cousin's done that.
Oh, my good fucking God. For Christ's sake.
My cousin, does a lot of yoga.
Let's just assume.
She teaches it.
Okay. Let's just assume that it's hot yoga. Okay?
Okay. So how do you feel about hot yoga?
Okay. So let's just say it's hot yoga. Now, to me, I do practice DDP yoga. I've done vinyasa yoga at one point. Allow me to say that this whole fucking hot yoga thing, to me, I'm not with it. I don't like it. If it's for your cup of tea, God bless you. But I don't believe in turning up a room at 110, 120 degrees to sweat even more because, number one, it's going to dehydrate you. Number two, I don't feel like it does anything for you. It may loosen up your muscles and the body and all that. Okay, I get that, but I don't see the point of it. But again, I don't know much about it. I wouldn't mind trying a class once, but this is just – that's insane. I just don't – I've heard people literally faint in the middle of sessions doing shit like this.
Oh,
and that's dangerous.
I'm sure.
All right? Now, assuming the idea that what she's trying to write is goat yoga – okay.
Well, maybe she should learn how to text or write or whatever, however she gets the words over.
But are those among you without sin cast the first stone? Apparently, you should be stoned, Larry. Okay, listen.
Ow!
People are not perfect out there. Did Jeremiah just throw that at you?
Where the hell did you get stoned from? Oh, man.
Good job, Jeremiah. Good job. All right.
It's a hell of an arm on him.
Apparently, Jeremiah can sense evil. Now, here's the thing. If it's this goat yoga shit that I've seen where they put a goat on top of your back, what the fuck?
I'm pretty sure my cousin's done goat yoga. I'm trying to think. My cousin teaches yoga. My cousin Stephanie. And she's traveled around the country, like around the world.
Is that beautiful lady that I had seen one time on your social media post?
Best. Tread lightly, my friend.
She's beautiful. What do you want me to say?
Tread lightly.
She's 21 or older, isn't she?
Yeah, she's 10 years younger than me.
So she's 28. Okay, yeah, it is that beautiful young lady that I've seen. Okay. So, listen, with no disrespect to her, but if she at this goat shit, give me a break. Who the fuck decided to put a goddamn goat on people's backs, like it's going to change your scope of yoga? What the hell is the goat supposed to do for you? Have you seen this crap?
I've seen it. I think she's done it with cats, actually. Maybe not goats. But, you know, like cats just walking around. Like, it just kind of calms you. Same with dogs or puppies, really.
Why don't they put a kitten on top? Why don't they put a dog, a puppy on top?
Why don't they
put a panda on top?
Well,
what the fuck is this goat shit?
Where the hell are you going to get a panda from? And they'll rip your head off.
I love pandas. You leave my brothers alone. All right? I just don't see the point to it. But the point is, I'm done with this question as far as I'm concerned. But hey, Stephanie, hello. Yes,
mute
you are
Mike.
Beautiful.
Mute is Mike.
You are nice, nice
mute
people.
It.
And I just wanted to...
Do not mess with the family, because if you do, not only do you have to answer to me, you'll have to answer to the patriarch of this whole establishment. All right? I see you shaking over there. You know what I'm talking about. Big Daddy Moore. You don't want to have to mess with him, because he will bite your head off, man. All right, unmute him. Unmute him.
Is this thing on?
All right. All right, let's wrap this up. Nico the Great from Twitter. Ugh, Greek. Writes, I am thinking about running a 10K, which is 6.2 miles, but there's no medal involved. Is it worth it? Personally,
Fuck no. Fuck no.
Wait, did we just agree on something?
I think we did. Holy God. Allow me to just say that to me, okay, this is just me. If you're going to put in that much work, if you ran a 5K and that's 3 miles, I can understand. Just like when I did the one in in Maryland. But listen, if you're going to fucking run double that and you're going to put in over an hour's worth of running, you best damn win a fucking medal. Because for something to show for it, at least they should give you a free buffet lunch or something like that. That's what we had on a 5K.
Is that why you did it?
So, yeah. Well, yeah. Listen, there are people who run for many, many different reasons.
Run for fun?
Nobody runs for fun. You run for something. Back you definitely 3? Do it for a medal, yeah. For sure.
All right.
So, absolutely. So, fans, if you have any questions, please write to us at yinandyangpodcast@gmail.com. Once again, that's yinandyangpodcast@gmail.com. So, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to say that our new tour for 2019 is going to be added. And in this tour itself, my friends, allow me to say this to you right now here, that it is now called We Have Come Here to Kick Ass and Chew Bubblegum, and We're All Out of Bubblegum Tour 2019. Larry, my next upcoming appearances definitely will be Chiller somewhere in April. I believe it's April 28th or 29th. 26th to the 28th. So I will certainly be there at Chiller. My friends Carol and Paula from the Magic Garden will be there for those of you kids of the 70s and 80s who grew up watching children's programming. They did a show called The Magic Garden. They are personal friends of mine. They will be there.
How about Tony Danza? Here.
Well, Tony Danza.
Mona.
Angela. Furlong, all right, will be there. All these people will be there.
Jason Priestley?
I get the fuck out of here. Like, I would want to meet that guy. I just no purpose. Listen, I'm not Ripo, okay? So, on top of that, I mean, so far the guest
list
is kind
of... He wasn't into 90210. He was into Melrose Place.
Well, the guest list is kind of blah right now.
Blah? So
I don't know, man.
Hal Linden.
Who?
Hal Linden. Barney from Barney Miller.
Never watched that show.
Oh, my God. The Amazing Kreskin?
Too white for me.
Dawson's Creek parent reunion?
I've met them already.
My friend, this is good. This is a lineup for the ages. Animal House, Otis Day. We like to dance with your ladies.
Okay. Let's see. So, obviously, WrestleMania weekend is going to be definitely showcased on tap.
That is going to be
at the same time.
Wild. I would like to announce that Talking More Wrestling will be broadcasting live from MetLife Stadium the afternoon of WrestleMania 35, which will emanate from MetLife Stadium in East Rutherford, New Jersey, Sunday, April 7th, only on the WWE Network. Right now, it's been announced that the WWE Universal Championship will be defended at
Okay, well, listen. Let's not promote. Oh, yeah, there is. I'm sorry. What was that? Shut up. I'm not talking to you. I'm sorry. Listen, let's not promote the card, okay? We don't work for WWE. They don't give us money to promote anything, all right? Now, if they gave me Kairi Sane's hand in marriage, we will promote everything every single day. But and speaking of my girl Kairi, I hope my future missus is okay.
She had a good showing in the Rumble.
She got thrown out hard, man.
She did. It sounded like something snapped too.
I'm really concerned for my wifey. So if anybody can please give me a
well, which one, Kairi, Asuka, or Io Shirai?
I got it. I love Kairi. I would take her over all three of them, or over the rest of the two. Yes.
Well, I was happy to see Casey Catanzaro. She is my go-to.
She did really well. And by the way, Lacey Evans is amazing.
Evans is awesome. I love Lacey Evans.
Excellent wrestler.
With all the nasties. What I'm
a little upset at is that they did not showcase my girl Vanessa Bourne.
Eh, I don't think she has enough pull just yet.
Hey, oh God, that woman is fine.
Zelina Vega coming out as Vega from Street Fighter.
That was so hot. My hormones were running when
and then
I saw that.
The return of Hornswoggle.
Yes, my man Hornswoggle. That was funny.
So it was a good, top to bottom, good show, but check it out this Saturday, 6:05 p.m. But yeah, WrestleMania, will you be joining us at WrestleMania on the live broadcast?
Am I actually getting an official invite on air?
Yes. Will you appear live at the Epic Tailgate Party at the MetLife Stadium parking lot WrestleMania Sunday?
Of course I am. You know I'll be there. You want my golden voice. I'll stop. You know you will. And then on top of that, by the way, my friends, I have another extra added date, June 14th to June 16th of 2019. I will be in the Monroeville Mall for the Living Dead Weekend, where I will actually meet the cast I will meet the cast of the original 1978 version of Dawn of the Dead.
That's cool.
By the way, that prick that I bought the DVD from, the extended mall hours cut, the DVD's fucked up.
Oh, no. Oh, you mean from Chiller?
Yeah. I am not happy, bro. You know that. I am not happy.
And also, I'd like to announce that August 10th and 11th, the Retro Gamers will be at the Long Island Retro Gaming Expo. We will have a table there set up. So please come on down to Garden City, New York, Cradle of Aviation Museum. Check out all things retro, and we will be there podcasting as well.
Oh, really? Okay.
Maybe if a certain host of a certain Yin and Yang podcast makes his way down to Garden City, maybe we can
You'll be there.
Crossover.
Well, I also want to go to that Too Cold Scorpio meetup with Monty and the Pharaoh.
Oh, yeah, I already warned him about you with that.
What do you mean you warned them about me? What?
I'm sorry, what?
How dare you?
What?
And with that said, do you have anything else to promote, like your Paul Heyman?
Nope, I'm good right now.
Thank God, because apparently...
Is this the last piece?
What now?
I can't have anything. Is this the last piece? All right.
What is this? I just received something from Jeremiah.
Huh?
Well, there's one other thing that we've forgot to promote after the tour. So WrestleMania is April the 7th, am I correct?
That is correct.
So ladies and gentlemen, emanating live after WrestleMania, the after WrestleMania after party at 365 Mormon Way in Merrick,
what?
New York, is going to be Larry's official after party.
Wait.
Where he will personally host a seafood buffet,
I'm not even
caviar,
gonna be there.
Wine, drinks, everything else, hosted by his new butler, Kenny, the homeless guy that was on the show.
You just gave out my address of the compound.
Come meet Larry, Curly, and Mo, his three dogs. Larry will be back. He's flying from East Rutherford all the way back to Merrick in his helicopter. So he will be there to host the party.
What is he doing? Mute him.
Everybody,
come dressed as a
professional wrestler or a diva. And ladies, you can only get in if you're single and you're hot. All right. And other than that, all right. Only if you're single and hot and you come in dressed as a female, you know, WWE talent or NXT talent. Personally, if you come in dressed as Kyrie Sane, you're mine.
Mute him. All right? Mute him.
Other than that, ladies and gentlemen, 365 Mormon Way, 365 Mormon Way, Merrick, New York.
What?
Be there or be square, like Larry.
Why can I say
tally ho?
I have to move. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you.